upon the words of.
And everyone else that just first maybe I should put them on the table.
Good afternoon. Welcome to the Solemn Liturgy through Friday. This evening at 6:30 p.m., Deacon Karen will lead Stations of the Cross. I invite you to join Deacon Karen at 6:30 this evening for the Stations of the Cross prayers. The order of worship is printed. Everyone has copy as well as the inserted passion, which the congregation will participate in, the passion narrative during the service. Let us prepare our hearts to worship.
Blessed be our God,
forever and ever. Amen.
Let us pray. Almighty God, we pray you graciously to behold this your family, for whom our Lord Jesus Christ was willing to be betrayed and given into the hands of sinners and to suffer death upon the cross, who now lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the book of Isaiah. See, my servant shall prosper. He shall be exalted and lifted up, and shall be very high. Just as there were many who were astonished at him, so Martin's appearance, beyond human semblance, and his form beyond that of mortals, For he shall startle many nations. Kings shall shut their mouths because of him. For that which had not been told them, they shall see, and that which they had not heard, they shall contemplate. Who has believed what we have heard? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? He grew up before him like a young plant, and like a wood on a dry ground. He had no form or majesty that we should look at him, nothing in his appearance that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by others, a man of suffering and acquainted with infirmity, and as one from whom others hide their faces, he was despised, and we held him of no account. Surely he has borne our infirmities and carried our diseases. Yet we accounted him stricken, struck down by God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions, crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the punishment that made us whole, and by his bruises we are healed. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have all turned our own way, and the Lord has handed him the iniquity of us all. He was oppressed, and he was afflicted. He did not open his mouth. Like a lamb that is led to the slaughter, and like a sheep that before its shearers is silent, so he did not open his mouth. By a perversion of justice he was taken away. Who could have imagined his future? He was cut off from the land of the living, stricken for the transgression of my people. They made his grave with the wicked and his tomb with the rich, but though he had done no harm, and there was no deceit in his mouth. Yet it was the will of the Lord to crush him with pain. When you make his life an offering for sin, he shall see his offspring, and shall prolong his days. Through him the will of the Lord shall prosper. Out of his anguish he shall see light. He shall find satisfaction through his knowledge. The righteous one, my servant, shall make many righteous, and he shall bear their iniquities. Therefore I will allot him a portion with the great, and he shall divide the spoil with the strong, because he poured out himself to death and was numbered with the transgressors. Yet he bore the sin of many and made intercession for the transgressors. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us read by whole verse alternately, portion of Psalm 22 in your bulletin. I will read the odd verses. My God, why have you forsaken me and are so far from my cry and from the words of my distress?
Oh my God, I cry in the daytime, but you do not answer. My night is well, but I find no rest.
Yet you are the Holy One, enthroned among the praises of Israel.
Our forefathers put their trust in you. They trusted in you, delivered them.
They cried out to you and were delivered. They trusted in you and were not put to shame.
But as for me, I am a worm and a man, scorned by all and despised by the people.
All who see me laugh me to scorn. They curl their lips and wag their heads, saying,
he trusted in the Lord, let him deliver him. Let them rescue him, if he delights in him.
Yet you are he who took me out of the womb and kept me safe upon my mother's breast.
I have been entrusted to you ever since I was born. You were my God when I was still in my mother's womb.
Be ye not far from me, for trouble is near, and there is none to help.
And I will write them on their mind. He also adds, I will remember their sins and their lawless deeds no more. Where there is forgiveness of these, there is no longer any offering for sin. Therefore, my friends, since we have confidence to enter the sanctuary by the blood of Jesus, by the new and living way that he opened for us through the curtain that is through his flesh, and since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us approach with true heart in full assurance of faith, with our hearts sprinkled clean from an evil conscience and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast to the confession of our hope without wavering, for who has promised is faithful. And let us consider how to provoke one another to love and good deeds, not neglecting to meet together, as is the habit of some, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Hear the passion of our Lord Jesus Christ, according to John. Jesus went out with his disciples across the Kidron Valley to a place where there was a garden, which he and his disciples entered. Now Judas, who betrayed him, also knew the place, because Jesus often met there with his disciples. So Judas brought a detachment of soldiers together with police from the chief priests and the Pharisees. And they came there with lanterns and torches and weapons. Then Jesus, knowing all that was to happen to him, came forward and asked them,
"Whom are you looking for?"
They answered,
"Jesus of Nazareth."
Jesus replied,
"I am he."
Judas, who betrayed him, was standing with them. When Jesus said to them, "I am he," they stepped back and fell to the ground. Again he asked them,
"Whom are you looking for?"
And they said,
"Jesus of Nazareth."
Jesus answered,
"I told you that I am he. So if you are looking for me, let these men go."
This was to fulfill the word that he had spoken, "I did not lose a single one of those whom you gave me." Then Simon Peter, who had a sword, drew it and struck the high priest's slave and cut off his right ear. The slave's name was Malchus. Jesus also said to Peter,
"Put your sword back into its sheath. Am I not to drink the cup that the Father has given me?"
So the soldiers, their officer, and the Jewish police arrested Jesus and bound him. First they took him to Annas, who was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, the high priest that year. Caiaphas was one of those who advised the Jews that it was better to have one person die for the people. Simon Peter and the other disciples followed Jesus. Since that disciple was known to the high priest, he went with Jesus into the courtyard of the high priest. But Peter was standing outside the gate. So the other disciple, who was known to the high priest, went out, spoke to a woman who guarded the gate, and brought Peter in. The woman said to Peter,
"You are not also one of this man's disciples, are you?"
Peter said,
"I am not."
Now the slaves and the police had made there a charcoal fire because it was cold, and they were standing around it and warming themselves. Peter also was standing with them and warming himself. Then the high priest questioned Jesus about the disciples and about his teachings. Jesus answered,
"I have spoken openly to the world. I have always taught in synagogues and in the temple, where all the Jews come together. I have said nothing in secret. Why do you ask me? Ask those who heard what I said to them. They know what I said.
When he had said this, one of the police standing nearby struck Jesus on his face, saying,
Is that how you answer the high priest?
Jesus answered,
I have spoken wrongly, testified to the wrong. But if I have spoken rightly, why do you strike me?
Then Annas sent him bound to Caiaphas, the high priest. Now Simon Peter was standing and warming himself. They asked him,
You are not also one of his disciples, are you?
Peter denied it and said,
I am not.
One of the slaves of the high priest, a relative of the man whose ear Peter had cut off, asked,
Didn't I not see you in the garden with him?
Again, Peter denied it, and at that moment the cock crowed. Then they took Jesus from Caiaphas to Pilate's headquarters. It was early in the morning. They themselves did not enter the headquarters so as to avoid ritual defilement and to be able to eat the Passover. So Pilate went out to them and said,
What accusation do you bring against this man?
John answered,
If this man were not a criminal, we would not have handed him over to you.
Pilate said to them,
Take him yourselves and judge him according to your law.
The Jews replied,
We are not permitted to put anyone to death.
This was fulfilled what Jesus had said when he indicated the kind of death he was to die. Then Pilate entered his headquarters again, summoned Jesus, and asked him,
Are you the king of the Jews?
Jesus answered,
Do you ask this on your own, or did others tell you about me?
Pilate replied,
I am not a Jew, am I? Your own nation and the chief priests have handed you over to me. What have you done?
Jesus answered,
My kingdom is not from this world. If my kingdom were from this world, my followers would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not from here.
Pilate asked him,
So you are a king?
Jesus answered,
You say that I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice.
Pilate asked him,
What is truth?
After he had said this, he went out to the Jews again and told them,
I find no case against him, but you have a custom that I release someone for you at the Passover. Do you want me to release from you the king of the Jews?
They shouted in reply,
Not this man, but Barabbas.
Now Barabbas was a bandit, and Pilate took Jesus and had him flogged, and the soldiers wove a crown of thorns and put it on his head, and they dressed him in a purple robe. They kept coming up to him, saying,
Hail, King of Jews!
And striking him on the face, Pilate went out again and said to them,
Look, I am bringing him out to you to let you know that I find no case against him.
So Jesus came out, wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe. Pilate said to him,
Here is the man.
When the chief priests and police saw him, they shouted,
Crucify him! Crucify him!
Pilate said to them,
Take him yourselves and crucify him. I find no case against him.
The Jews answered him,
We have a law, and according to that law, he ought to die because he has claimed to be the Son of God.
Now when Pilate heard this, he was more afraid than ever. He entered his headquarters again and asked Jesus,
Where are you from?
But Jesus gave him no answer. Pilate therefore said to him,
Do you refuse to speak to me? Do you not know that I have the power to release you and the power to crucify you?
Jesus answered him,
You would have no power over me unless it had been given to you from above. Therefore, the one who handed me over to you is guilty of a greater sin.
From then on, Pilate tried to release him, but the Jews cried out,
If you release this man, you are no friend of the emperor. Everyone who claims to be a king sets himself against the emperor.
When Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus outside and sat on the judge's bench at the place called the Stone Pavement, or in Hebrew, Gabbatha. Now it was the day of preparation for Passover, and it was about noon. Pilate said to the Jews,
"Here is your king."
They cried out,
"Away with him! Away with him! Crucify him!"
Pilate asked them,
"Shall I crucify your king?"
The chief priests answered,
"We have no king but the emperor."
Then he handed them over to them to be crucified. So they took Jesus and carried the cross by himself. He went out into what is called the place of the skull, which in Hebrew is called Golgotha. There they crucified him, and with two others, one on either side, with Jesus between them. Pilate also had an inscription written and put on the cross. It read, "Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews." Many of the Jews read this inscription because the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city. And it was written in Hebrew, in Latin, and in Greek. Then the chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate,
"Do not write the King of the Jews." But the man said, "I am the King of Jews."
Pilate answered,
"What I have written, I have written."
When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his clothes and divided them into four parts, one for each soldier. They took his tunic. Now the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from the top to the bottom. So they said to one another,
"Let us not tear it, but cast lots to see who will get it."
This was to fulfill the scripture saith, "They divided my clothes among them, and for my clothing they cast lots." And that was what the soldiers did. Meanwhile, standing near the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciples whom he loved standing beside her, he said to his mother,
"Woman, here is your son."
Then he said to his disciple,
"Here is your mother."
And from that hour, the disciple took her into his own home. After this, when Jesus knew that it was all now finished, he said, "The fulfills the scripture,
I am thirsty."
A jar full of sour wine was standing there. So he put a sponge full of wine on a branch of hyssop and held it to his mouth. Then Jesus had received the wine, he said,
"It is finished."
Then he bowed his head and gave up the spirit. Since it was the day of preparation, the Jews did not want the bodies left on the cross during the Sabbath, especially because that Sabbath was a great day, was a day of great solemnity. So they asked Pilate to have his legs of the crucified man broken and their bodies removed. Then the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and of the other who had been crucified with him. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. Instead, one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and at once blood and water came out. He who saw this has testified so that it may, that you may also believe. This testimony is true, and he might, and he knows that he tells the truth. These things occurred so that the scripture might be fulfilled. None of his bones shall be broken. And another passage of scripture says, they will look on the one whom they have pierced. After these things, Joseph of Arimathea, who was a disciple of Jesus, though a secret one because of his fear of the Jews, asked Pilate to let him take the body of Jesus. Pilate gave him permission, and he came and removed the body. Nicodemus, who had at first come to Jesus by night, also came, bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, weighing about 100 pounds. They took the body of Jesus and wrapped it in the spices in linen cloths, according to the burial custom of the Jews. Now there was a garden, the place where he was crucified. And in the garden there was a new tomb, which no one had ever been laid. And so because of it, the Jewish day of Bahrke had preparation, and the tomb was nearby. They laid Jesus there.
Facts are safe, familiar, empirical, which by the way means they are verifiable by observation or experience rather than opinion and theory. I loved working as an engineer when I was in automobile racing. While some savants have taken the development and preparation of race cars to an art form, for the most part, everything we did was based on real-world testing results and proven effective strategies. In other words, we relied heavily on facts. It is therefore quite surprising and perhaps proof of God's sense of humor that I would end up in a career, a life, really, that is so heavily based on the unknown, requiring giant leaps of faith and the attempted understanding of that which cannot be understood. However, some aspects of theology are indeed provable. Take, for instance, church history. We know from informed, believable, and verifiable knowledge that Martin Luther posted his 95 theses on the church door in Wittenberg, Germany, on October 31st, 1517. This is just accepted as true. Now, if you read a particular book that argues what was actually in those 95 short writings, and it deviates from the commonly accepted norms, that could either be labeled as heresy, or at the very least, revisionist history. And there's a lot of that going on these days in both theology and in world history. We also rely upon the writings and thoughts of those who we consider to be experts. Thomas Aquinas's magnum opus, the Summa Theologica, and the Confessions of Augustine are two such dissertations that help establish some form of clarity. Even Roman Catholic encyclicals issued by the Pope or other high-ranking members of the magisterium, sometimes referred to as papal bulls, not going to touch that. These can be helpful, at least, in providing some sort of jumping-off point. This method of establishing a starting point, whether you agree with it or not, is useful when contemplating Christian morals and ethics. This type of guidance is useful when we start to ponder or study some of the more complex and controversial and less understood issues of our faith. Arguably, Good Friday can fall into that category. I do not think that I need to go into exactly what went on that day from a historical point of view, as even a newcomer to the faith is provided much of the background through scripture, as well as complementary writings and the majestic and complex liturgies of Holy Week. But it is on this day of the calendar and the church year that we come face to face with the fact that Jesus of Nazareth, who we believe was and is the Son of God, died this day on the cross. Through today's liturgy, we reenact the events of that day. I prefer to use the prayer book liturgy for Good Friday, which we are using, but perhaps you've taken part in a service not found in any of our books, which is why I don't use it, titled The Seven Last Words of Jesus on the Cross, also sometimes referred to as the three-hour service. Be thankful this one isn't 3 hours. Whatever Good Friday service one leans toward, they all focus on Christ's execution on the cross and his passing from life to death. This is the same boundary that we must all face one day. And it is the one that Christ experienced on the cross. Eventually, each of us will be forced to deal with what Jesus faced that day when we stand at the edge of our own existence as we know it. I don't want to be overly morbid, but at that time, we will find ourselves in the presence of the one who created us and gives us life. So, as we prepare for that day, for our own Good Friday, to help us better understand the gift that Christ gave us on that Friday, which is why it's called Good Friday. It was good for us. As he hung on the cross, let us now remember the words of the one who is seated on the throne in Revelation 21:5. Behold, I am making all things new. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Dear people of God, our Heavenly Father sent His Son into the world, not to condemn the world, but that the world through Him might be saved, that all who believe in Him might be delivered from the power of sin and death, and become heirs with Him of everlasting life. We pray, therefore, for people everywhere according to their needs. Let us pray for the Holy Catholic Church of Christ throughout the world, for its unity in witnesses and service, for all bishops and other ministers, and for the people whom they serve, for our presiding bishop, Lee, for all Christians in this community, for those who long to be baptized all over the world, that God will confirm His church in faith, increase it in love, and preserve it in peace.
Almighty and everlasting God, by whose Spirit the whole body of your faithful people is governed and sanctified, receive our supplications and prayers which we offer before you for all members of your holy church, that in their vocation and ministry they may truly and devoutly serve you through our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ.
Amen.
Let us pray for all nations and peoples of the earth, and for those in authority among them. For Joe, the President of the United States, for the Congress and Supreme Court, for members and representatives of the United Nations, for all who serve the common good, that by God's help they may seek justice and truth, and live in peace and concord.
Almighty God, kindle, we pray, in every heart the true love of peace, and guide with your wisdom those who take counsel for the nations of the earth, that in tranquility your dominion may increase,
until the earth is filled with the knowledge of your love through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray for all who suffer and are afflicted in body or in mind, for the sick, the wounded, and the crippled, for those in loneliness, fear, and anguish, for those who face temptation, doubt, and despair, for the sorrowful and bereaved, for prisoners and captives, and those in mortal danger, that God in his mercy will comfort and relieve them, and grant them the knowledge of his love, and stir up in us the will and patience to minister to their needs.
Gracious God, the comfort of all who sorrow, the strength of all who suffer, let the cry of those in misery and need come to you, that they may find your mercy present with them in all their afflictions. And give us, we pray, the strength to serve them for the sake of him who suffered for us, your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray for all who have not received the gospel of Christ, for those who have never heard the word of salvation, for those who have lost their faith, for those hardened by sin or indifference, for the contemptuous and the scornful, for those who are enemies of the cross of Christ and persecute his disciples, for those who in the name of Christ have persecuted others, that God will open their hearts to truth and lead them to faith and obedience.
Merciful God, creator of all the peoples of the earth and lover of souls, have compassion on all who do not know you as you are revealed in your Son, Jesus Christ. Let your gospel be preached with grace and power to those who have not heard it. Turn the hearts of those who resist it, and bring home to your fold those who have gone astray, that there may be one flock under one shepherd, Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us commit ourselves to our God and pray for the grace of a holy life, that with all who have departed this world and have died in the peace of Christ, and those whose faith is known to God alone, we may be accounted worthy to enter into the fullness of the joy of our Lord and receive the crown of life in the day of resurrection.
O God of unchangeable power and eternal light, Look favorably on your whole church, that wonderful and sacred mystery. By the effectual working of your providence, carry out in tranquility the plan of salvation. Let the whole world see and know that things which were cast down are being raised up, and things which had grown old are being made new, and that all things are being brought to their perfection by him through whom all things were made, your Son, Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Behold the wood of the cross on which the humble world's salvation.
Come, let us adore him.
Behold the wood of the cross on which hung the world's salvation.
Come, let us adore him. Come, let us adore him.
Thank you.
May God be merciful to us and bless us, show us the light of his countenance, and come to us.
Let your ways be known on earth, your saving health among all nations.
Let the peoples praise you, O God, let all the peoples praise you.
We glory in your cross, O Lord, and praise and glorify your holy resurrection. For by virtue of your cross, joy has come to the whole world.
We adore you, O Christ, and we bless you.
Because by your holy cross, you have redeemed the world.
If we have died with him, we shall also live with him. And if we endure, we shall also reign with him.
We adore you, O Christ, and we bless you. Because by your holy cross, you have redeemed the world.
O Savior of the world, who by thy cross and precious blood hast redeemed us.
Save us and help us, we humbly beseech thee, O Lord.
Thank you.
our sins against God and our neighbors. Most merciful God,
we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen.
Let us now pray in the words our Lord and Savior taught us. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Body of Christ, the bread of heaven. The blood of Christ, the cup of salvation. The body of Christ, the bread of heaven. The blood of Christ, the cup of salvation. The body of Christ, the bread of heaven. The blood of Christ, the cup of salvation. The body of Christ, the bread of heaven. The body of Christ, bread of heaven. The body of Christ, the 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 bread of heaven.
The blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, preserve your soul. The blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, preserve your soul. Life everlasting.
living God. We pray you to set your passion, cross, and death between your judgment and our souls, now and in the hour of our death. Give mercy and grace to the living, pardon and rest to the dead, to your holy church, peace and concord, and to us sinners, everlasting life and glory. For with the Father and the Holy Spirit, you live and reign, one God, now and forever.
Amen.